Remember when this happened? What about this? And this? None of it would have happened if not for this.
One last gasp here for the Oilers. Bergeron fans on a pass. Stefan steals and he'll ice it.
This flub is much, much more than just a hilarious addition to the NHL's all-time blooper reel. Patrik Stefan's infamous, iconic fuck-up indirectly led to the Chicago Blackhawks winning 3 Stanley Cups and forming a mini-dynasty in the 2010s. How exactly? Let me explain.
While Michael Jordan and the Bulls were kicking the shit out of everyone and winning ring after ring after ring in the 1990s, elsewhere in Chicago, the Blackhawks were sinking from a perennial playoff contender into the depths of mediocrity. In 1998, the Blackhawks would miss out on the playoffs for the first time since 1970, ending a streak of reaching the playoffs that had spanned for 28 years. To this day, that's the second longest playoff appearance streak in NHL history. But despite making it to the dance all of those years, none of those Hawks teams were able to win a Stanley Cup. The Hawks boasted star players like Tony Esposito, Denny Savard, Chris Chelios, and Jeremy Roenick, but they could never get the job done. 1998 wasn't just a blip on the radar. It was a sign of things to come. The Blackhawks would go on to make the playoffs just once in their next 10 seasons, putting together some of their worst teams since the 1950s. That all changed in 2007 when they drafted this guy. Patrick Kane was instrumental in bringing the Blackhawks franchise back to life. Joining a core of drafted and developed talent like Jonathan Toews and Duncan Keith, Kane helped the Blackhawks break their massive 49-year Stanley Cup drought in 2010 and then won twice more in 2013 and 2015, turning the Blackhawks into a modern-day dynasty. With 389 goals, 1,022 points, a Hart Trophy, a Conn Smythe Trophy, and an Art Ross Trophy to his name, along with those 3 Stanley Cups, you can start to make the argument that Patrick Kane is the best player in Blackhawks history. But if Patrik Stefan puts the puck into that empty net on that dark, cold night in Edmonton on January the 4th, 2007, Kane never becomes a Blackhawk, and these banners more than likely never get raised to the rafters.
Okay, slow down. What does this random early January game between the Edmonton Oilers and the Dallas Stars have to do with the Chicago Blackhawks? Let's go back in time for some context.
Fresh off of winning their 1,000th game as an NHL franchise, one that snapped a 4-game losing streak, the Oilers welcomed the Stars into town. Edmonton was sitting 9th in the Western Conference, and every single point mattered for this team. The year before, the Oilers had gone on an incredible, unexpected playoff run that involved taking down the President's Trophy winning Detroit Red Wings and 2 other strong teams, the San Jose Sharks and the Anaheim Ducks, to make it through the Western Conference. That run would end with a heartbreaking loss in Game 7 of the Stanley Cup Final to the Carolina Hurricanes. Still, this was a team that genuinely had aspirations of going deep into the playoffs again. But instead, here the Oilers were in January, on the outside, looking in. The heartbreak for the Oilers didn't end after Game 7 in Carolina. No. It was just the beginning. Almost immediately after losing the Stanley Cup, Chris Pronger asked for a trade. Pronger was instrumental to the Oilers' success the previous year. His Norris-caliber season was one thing, but his showing in the playoffs was a different animal. Pronger logged an average of 31 minutes per game for the Oilers during their playoff run. He was just on a different planet. So Pronger asking for a trade was simply devastating for the team. And beyond trading Pronger away, the Oilers also lost a whole bunch of their key veteran players, like third-line center Mike Pekka and trade deadline acquisitions Yaroslav Spacek and Sergei Samsonov. Still, despite the exodus of veteran talent, there was optimism that Edmonton, with their young core of guys who enjoyed breakout seasons like Ales Hemsky, Sean Horkoff, Rafi Torres, and Jarrett Stoll, along with the newly acquired Joffrey Lupul, were still deep enough to be a good team.
Plus, Ryan Smith, the heart and soul of the team, he was still around. And he always would be, right? Right?
Things didn't go as planned for the Oilers. They got off to a solid start to the season, winning 6 of their first 8 games, but eventually, the ship slowly started to sink. The magic that was there the previous year was gone. It became evident that nobody was able to step up and fill the massive void that Pronger left in the blue line. Not Daniel Charnqvist, not Jan Hede, not a 20-year-old Ladislav Schmid. Nobody could step up and be the force of nature that Pronger was the year before. Further, that deep offense that was supposed to carry the team went dry. The newly acquired Joffrey Lupo was a disappointment. Stoll, Torres, and Horkov didn't take step forwards like everybody expected, and Ales Hemsky dealt with injuries.
Thankfully, Ryan Smith was there, leading the charge with 19 goals through 28 games at New Year's. If he wasn't there, things could have been a lot worse.
I could talk about the magic of that 2005-6 team for hours on end, and I could even go on about the rotting husk of a team it left behind 2006-7. But that's not what you're here for. You want to hear about how Patrik Stefan fucked up and changed everything. So let's talk about that Stefan guy. Stefan was a big, skilled center from the Czech Republic who, as a teenager, was already ripping it up at the professional level for the Long Beach Ice Dogs at the IHL. At the 1999 draft, the Atlanta Thrashers took him with the first overall pick. It was also their first ever choice as an expansion team. And to be blunt, he kind of set the tempo for the franchise moving forward. Right behind him, the Vancouver Canucks used the second and third overall picks, which general manager Brian Burke had acquired in an insane carousel of trades earlier, on Daniel and Henrik Sedin, two Swedish twins who would only come over to North America if they could play together. While the Sedins went on to become, well, the Sedins, two future Hall of Famers, Stefan struggled to live up to his billing as a top pick. He scored just 5 goals in his rookie season on a historically shitty Thrashers team that won a whopping 14 games. It didn't get much better for Stefan as he plateaued as a 40-point scorer in the NHL. He was the biggest first overall bust since Alexander Daigle in 1993 and would be until Neil Yakupov came around over a decade later. After 6 seasons in Atlanta, Stefan, the guy who the Thrashers were going to build their franchise around, got traded to the Dallas Stars for journeyman depth forward Nico Kapanen and a 7th round pick. Maybe Stefan could turn his career on in Dallas? You know, playing for an organization that was a little bit less of a disaster than the Atlanta Thrashers? Nope. There would be no redemption arc for Stefan in Dallas. Instead, he would give himself a moment that would perfectly define his entire career. A moment that was even worse than being known as one of the biggest draft busts of all time. So here we are in early January. We have the Oilers and the Stars playing in Edmonton, and the Oilers go ahead and jump out to a 4-1 lead in the first half of the game. But after that, the Stars storm back with 4 goals of their own to take a 5-4 lead in the third period. Then, with just a few seconds left in the clock, Stefan picked up a flub-errant pass by Marc-Andre Bergeron and cruised in towards the Oilers' empty net, ready to seal the victory for Dallas. You know what happens next.
Stefan steals and he'll ice it. Oh, at least I thought he was gonna, until he blew it. That's unbelievable. Here come the Oilers the other way, and Hemsky's loose. Hemsky, he scored! Can you believe what we just saw?
This clip is honestly completely insane and it never gets old. You can rewind it, knowing what's gonna happen, and still be surprised when he doesn't put the puck in the back of the net. Just in case you weren't aware of just how insanely bad this play was, Patrik Stefan's old teammate from Atlanta, Ray Ferraro, was commentating the game for the Oilers on Sportsnet, and he absolutely tore into Stefan.
That's the most ridiculous thing I've ever seen. Patrik Stefan, you should be embarrassed for what you just did. That does not belong in the National Hockey League.
Thankfully for Stefan, the Stars avenged him and ended up winning the game in the shootout. It was sort of an anticlimactic result for the Oilers, who appeared to have been given divine intervention from the hockey gods as compensation for a flubbed call a couple of months earlier. Back in November, the Oilers thought they had tied a game against these same Dallas Stars with just 5 seconds left on the clock. But that goal was called back because referee Mick Magoo was adamant that Sean Horkoff had won a faceoff using his glove, even though it was very clear that he didn't use his glove. But still, if I told anybody at Rexall Place the Oilers would get a loser point as Stefan was casually strolling to the empty net, they'd have been thrilled.
So the desperate Oilers took that point and ran with it. Into a wall.
The Oilers didn't build from the momentum handed to them by Stefan's gaffe. Instead, they carried on the way they had been playing for much of the season, which was to win one, lose one, win two, lose two, over and over and over and over again, failing to gain any ground in the standings. By the time the trade deadline rolled around at the end of February, Edmonton was 8 points out of a playoff spot. General manager Kevin Lowe had gone all in at last year's trade deadline, but that wasn't going to happen again. Instead, the Oilers were going to be sellers. Ryan Smith was due to become an unrestricted free agent in the offseason, and him and Lowe couldn't come to terms on a contract extension. Smith was asking for a long-term deal worth $5 million annually, which was pretty reasonable given the fact he had scored 36 goals the year prior. Apparently, Smith and Lowe were $100,000 off in their negotiations. So, to not risk losing him for nothing in free agency, Lowe sent Smith to the New York Islanders for Ryan O'Mara, Robert Nilsson, and a first-round pick the team would later use on Alex Plante, also known as nothing. The trade was an absolute gut punch for Oilers fans. After watching the team lose Game 7 of the Stanley Cup Finals, having an exodus of players leave over the summer, and the team imploding the following year, Smith getting traded might have been the worst thing yet. Ironically, the Oilers were retiring Mark Messier's number 11 the night Smith was dealt. It was awkward. Lowe, who had won 6 Stanley Cups with Messier as a teammate, was noticeably not in attendance. I wonder why.
I mean, why sign the heart and soul of your team so he can play his entire career in a city that he loves, in front of fans that love him even more, just so that you can save like $100,000 against the salary cap and get a package of magic beans in return?
After dealing Smith away, the Oilers went into a tailspin. Their 3-0 loss to the Phoenix Coyotes the night of the trade deadline would be their second loss in what would eventually become a 12-game losing streak. The Smithless Oilers would win just 2 of their final 19 games, with their only regulation win coming in their season finale against the Calgary Flames. The Oilers finished that season with 71 points in the standings. Given what the team went through in the 2010s, it doesn't seem that bad, but at this time, it really was. The 2006-07 season was the franchise's worst finish in over a decade. The post-Smith skid was bad enough for the Oilers to slide all the way down the standings to a tie with the Chicago Blackhawks for 5th last in the league. Now, this is important because back in this time, only the bottom 5 teams in the league were eligible to go into the draft lottery for a chance at the first overall pick. And the Oilers and Blackhawks were tied for that spot with 71 points, but the Blackhawks had won 31 games while the Oilers had won 32. So that meant Chicago was in the draft lottery and Edmonton wasn't. And whose name got drawn at that lottery?
This is where that random, inexplicable point that the Oilers earned in early January thanks to Stefan's flub becomes so important. If he puts the puck into that net and they lose the game in regulation, the Oilers are in 5th last and they're in the draft lottery and the Blackhawks aren't.
That means Patrick Kane never becomes a Blackhawk. Chicago ends up choosing 6th overall the 2007 draft. Maybe they go with Sam Gagne, Kane's London Knights teammate like the Oilers did. Maybe they take somebody else like Jakub Voracek or Logan Couture. Who knows? But nobody they take is as much of a game changer as Kane, and Chicago probably doesn't win those 3 Stanley Cups. I mean, to be fair, it's not like Kane was some one-man team that won the Blackhawks 3 Stanley Cups by himself in 2010, 13, and 15. Like, they had a lot of good players in Jonathan Toews, Duncan Keith, Marian Hossa, and so on, but Kane's elite offense and his knack for clutch goals put them over the top. I mean, you could argue that they win 1 Stanley Cup without him, but I don't think they're winning all 3. Elsewhere, Edmonton presumably wins that draft lottery and gets the first overall choice in the draft. It's a nice consolation prize after losing the Stanley Cup the year before and losing their heart and soul player at the trade deadline. Would Kane have been enough to drag the Oilers back into the playoffs? Would he have been a good enough player for them to rebuild around, resulting in them not going through their infamous oil change tanking days in the 2010s? Would that mean no Taylor Hall, no Ryan Nugent-Hopkins, no Connor McDavid? But knowing the Oilers, it wouldn't have been shocking if they went in a different direction. It's hard to believe now, knowing what we know, but Kane wasn't a slam dunk to be picked first overall. Kyle Turris was the top-ranked skater heading into that draft, and he was a big, skilled center that the Oilers really needed. He was also a good old Canadian kid from British Columbia, so there's a good chance that he's the guy Edmonton uses with that hypothetical top pick. Maybe Kane ends up as a member of the Philadelphia Flyers, who picked number 2 that year. That would mean this never happens to them. Maybe he's scoring that goal for the Flyers instead, and they're the ones ending a Stanley Cup drought.
Thankfully for the Blackhawks, Stefan did flub that shot. Who knows what would have happened if he didn't?